His name is Pastor MJ Reid. He moves very extensively, not only as a pastor, but as a teacher. He has a grace for the authentic apostolic. He pastors an amazing church. So if you got family in Michigan, it's called therivermi.org. Amen. And he has some dynamic teachings on there that you can avail yourself. We trust him wholeheartedly. Amen. We've known each other for probably how long now, Pastor Reid? 20 years, amen. I was skinnier, and he was definitely skinnier, amen. See, every time he's got up here, he slayed me a little bit. So, you know, this is my last opportunity. No, but he's an amazing friend, amen, an amazing man of God. Ephesians 4:11 says this: God gave apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers for the perfecting or maturing of the saints, that you may reach the measure and the stature of the fullness of Christ, so that they would empower you to do the work of the ministry, to preach, to cast out devils. Come on, church, to lay hands on the sick. I want you to stand on your feet as we honor the dynamic gift of Apostle Marlin J. Reid. Can we give God a shout of praise for him right now in Jesus' mighty name? Come on, y'all can do better than that. Come on. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Come on, lift your hands up all over this place. Let's give God some glory. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you. We give you praise and glory.
Born of a living stone, where your praises are enthroned,
as you rose from death and power.
As you rose from death in power,
come rise within our worship.
Come rise within our worship.
Ride in on our praise.
Ride in on our praise.
And show the hand.
And show the hand that caused you raised.
Clothe us in your glory.
Clothe us in your glory.
And draw us by your grace.
And draw us by your grace.
Of your presence. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We give you praise. We give you glory. We are your people, lively stones in the building. We are the habitation of your glory. Lord, we thank you, brick upon brick, stone upon stone. We form the holy habitation. Lord, be pleased to dwell. We are your servants. We are your body. Lord, we love you today and we exalt you high above the heavens. Lord, there's no one else like you. You're the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of Elijah, the God of David. You're the covenant-keeping God. Father, we thank you. You're the God of war. Hallelujah. We thank you that you're Lord God, strong and mighty, invincible and undefeatable. But Lord, you're gracious and merciful and kind. And Lord, today we ask you to stretch out your hand to heal and to do signs and wonders in the name of your son, Jesus. Jesus, be lifted up. Let every man be brought down. That Jesus Christ of Nazareth will be lifted up and exalted in the midst of your people. Lord, I am nothing. You are everything. I decrease that you might increase. Breathe upon your people a fresh anointing, a fresh oil upon our head. Father, I pray that the gifts of the Spirit would be activated, that the eyes of our understanding would be flooded with light, that the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of you would encompass us today. Father, we want to see. Open our eyes that we can see that there are more with us than there are with them. Open our eyes today to see into the glory realm of all things are possible. Lord, we thank you now. We give you praise. Holy Spirit, have control. Have your way. We won't stop you. We won't hinder you. Amen. Amen. You can tone it down. Amen. We thank God. He knows that's my favorite song. Go ahead and before you sit down, go find at least two or three people and praise the Lord and greet them. Say hello to somebody. We take a few seconds just to get out your seat and greet some people. Amen. I know people have come in. You wanted to say hi. Go ahead and say hi to them. Greet them. Praise the Lord to them. You got a couple of seconds to run from the front to the back and shake hands. If you see somebody you don't know, it's time for you to introduce yourself to that person and greet them and praise the Lord with them. Amen. I like to break the tension in the room. Amen. And I don't like to eat with strangers. Amen. There's no strangers in here. We get ready to dine when the Spirit of the Lord is here. In the name of Jesus, Father, we thank you. Amen. Hallelujah. That's right. You got a second. You go ahead and shake hands. Praise the Lord with them. Tell them they look nice. Somebody's waiting for somebody to see them shoes or that hat or that jacket. They want somebody to say, you look sharp. Go ahead and give it to them. Amen. You look good. Amen. Praise looks good on you today. Amen. For the Lord is good, and his mercy endureth forever. That's what they said as the glory cloud came out of the tabernacle and filled the room, and nobody could stand. For the Lord is good, and his mercy endureth forever. Amen. Hallelujah. How many are ready for the word of the Lord? I'm not going to have you in here long. I promise to get you out of here at 3 o'clock. My plane leaves tomorrow, so I'll get you out of here in good time. Amen. Amen. I know one thing. The spirit of man cannot receive more than the seed of man can endure. So I'm not, you didn't catch that. Some of y'all will catch that next week. Amen. You said you did get that. I got that. Okay. Y'all are not slow. Amen. Amen. You know, you got a lot of, we have a deficit in the body of Christ today. We have a lot, we have the slowest Christians we've ever had in any generation. We got more information, more books on anything, but it seems that the more information we get, the dumber and quality of our Christians gets lower and lower. Amen. Sad to say that. But it's true. It's sad, but it's true. Amen. So I greet you in that name that's above every name, the name of Jesus. Amen. And we're excited. You know, I like coming here. It's like second home church, and we love your pastor and his wife and the family. Amen. And we thank God for you. You are the great and the mighty people. Amen. I preach all across this country and go to many different places. For 16 years, I traveled extensively as a revivalist, evangelist, even in other parts of the world, crusades in India and other countries. And I tell you what, I'd rather preach here than half the places I've been to preach at. Because I like coming to a church where the Spirit is high and willing. Everywhere you'd be surprised. The Holy Ghost can't have his way in a lot of places. We have everything to do with the manifestation of the Spirit.
Well, I'm waiting on revival.
We are revival. We are the church. We are the door. We decide when glory is going to come on the earth. We are the treasure. We have this treasure in our earthen vessels. If we come in here and decide the power is going to fall, it's going to fall. If we come in here in unity and decide we're going to have the glory cloud, it's going to come. Because we are the body of Christ upon the earth. Amen. That's why the devil fights us with unity. That's why the devil fights us with schisms and offenses and makes us fall out and break from each other, because as long as there's breaks like that, there's not going to be unity. You see, in the Old Testament, they didn't have to have all that unity. It was Moses, and that's it. Moses said, you're going to die, you're going to die. They didn't have to call in a board or a troop of intercessors to intercede whether you're going to fall into the earth. God said, you're going to die, and 70,000 fell in one day. Amen. We don't live under that government now. We have a different government now. We have apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers now. God speaks through people. Amen. Jesus is the voice that he's speaking through now. So now, because of all these people and all this delusion, God's Spirit has been poured out upon men. Do you know there's over 700 million, I can say this, tongue-talking believers on planet Earth right now? 700 million. You know, Hollywood tries to act like we're stupid and tries to make fun of us, and worldly people who don't know nothing about God mock us. But we're not a bunch of country bumpkins handling snakes and drinking strychnine. Amen. We're not a bunch of goofballs in the Appalachian Mountain. No, we are doctors, lawyers, bishops. We're all kind of people from all walks of life. Look at somebody say 700 million? It's only 7 billion people on the planet. Do you know that means that 1/10 of the Earth's population is tongue talking? Throw that ball over you. I said one. Look at somebody say 1/10. 1/10 of the world's population speaks in tongues and has experienced the baptism of the Holy Ghost. What does that mean? That means the devil is working overtime to keep us disjointed. Because if the church ever comes in unity and 700 people, 700 million people hit their knees at one time in unity, the earth is going to shake. The heavens going to have to open up and Jesus going to have to come back. Some of y'all are catching with it.
What are you talking about? What that mean?
Our greatest glory is in unity. It's sad to say it. The true power of the church is how well can we walk together. That's why walking in love is so important. Amen. The Bible says, started preaching. I'm just meddling now. We thank God for your pastor. I watched him grow up. Yeah, I did know him when he was a lot skinnier. He tried to throw a jab at me, but I'm virtually skinny still. I got a little comfort fat on me now, just for comfort. That's all. It's just a little bit of, it's a little softer, gentler evangelist. What it is. Keep on living. I just turned 50 in July, so I'm at the age now where everything has to count. Not like it did before, but it always had to count. But it really has to count. If you're 50, raise your hand. Nobody here. Anybody over 50? Amen. Good. That's nothing. That's a good. You got about 20 summers left. You 40. You got about 30 summers left. You over 70. You might have 5 to 10 summers left. Do you understand how it's crucial for you to get busy and do whatever you're gonna do? Right. You ain't got time to lollygag. You ain't got time to waste time dating somebody for 9 years and they ain't proposed to you. You ain't got time to waste your time with people who are holding up. Amen. People will hold you up and delay you. Amen. You don't have time to be working with something foolish that's not going to produce any results. Look at somebody say, God put you in time, on time, so you can get busy before you run out of time. God, what if God had a set number of people you were supposed to win to Christ before you come see him? What if he know there's a number that you're supposed to reach, and then he's going to lay that number next to the number you actually reached? People think heaven's going to be great, but the Bible says there's going to be a lot of weeping, and he'll have to wipe away our tears. You wonder why? Heaven ain't going to be the same experience for everybody.
I'm just going to try to make it in. That's all you're going to do.
Me, I'm going to have a mansion. Me, come on, I'm going to have, come on, I'm going to. Don't look at me like that. God is not a communist. There ain't no equality here. You barely make it in and stand next to somebody whose whole family got burned alive for the gospel and preached the gospel and got people saved. And you still tell, I just made it in. I just tried my best to stop watching Netflix all day. It was so hard for me to stop fornicating, but I did finally right before the end. Don't look at me like that. Say, it's going to get better. Look at somebody. Say, he's going to get better. It's going to be more encouraging as we go. You don't know what you have. You don't know what you have in this pastor and this woman of God. You all are familiar with, can I take my time for a few minutes? You all are familiar with COVID. That's all they talked about for the last 3 years. But are you aware of the effects that COVID has had on the church? Do you not know that 70,000 churches have shut down, never to return? 70,000 just in the Midwest and South on this side of the country. We ain't talking about California and out that way. 70,000 churches have shut down. Now, some would argue and say that's a shame because we need churches where people, even a bad church is better than no church, right? But on the other hand, we could say if you could not survive COVID, maybe you weren't supposed to. And what we have now is we have the mega church is suffering because they can't have all them people in it together in the threat of sickness. So they've been going and shutting down, and they're trying to have tests and shooting people with vaccines so they can go back to have the church. Personally, I didn't take the vaccine. I'm a non-vaxxer. If that bothers you, then I'm sorry. I'm non-vaxxer. I didn't shut my church down during the pandemic. We stayed open. We was having revivals, healing services, miracles. Nobody died in my church. People got COVID, stayed home, and came home after they got it over with. Amen. Because we know why? Because we rebuked it. That's why. Because we stood against it. COVID is not the head of the church. Jesus is. COVID don't decide when church going to happen. Jesus decides when church is going to happen. Amen. There's a spirit of fear that's moving across the land. And many people are dying before their time because they opened the door to death through fear. You have to be careful how you walk around being afraid and being scared of stuff. See, first of all, my life is in Jesus' hands. I'm not going nowhere till my assignment is over. I'm going to say it again. I'm not going nowhere till my assignment is over. So no disease or anything else is going to stop me fulfilling my purpose. But see, if you don't know that, the devil will talk you into dying early and dying before your time. And I don't care about dying early because I'm going to heaven when I die. What we living right for and doing all we can if heaven ain't better than what we got down here. Heaven ain't going to be no place with white robes and winged angels walking around in clouds of smoke. No, heaven is going to be like New York, Los Angeles, and the greatest metropolis put together in the center of the universe. And all beings and creatures from across the universe, things you've never seen, will be there bowing before the throne and serving tribute. It's going to be a metropolitan city with no need for electricity because the power of God's going to power everything. I can't wait to get in my spacecraft and cruise like Captain Kirk throughout the galaxies, flying through nebulas at magnificent speeds. I can't get no help in here. Eye has not seen, ear has not heard, neither is it entered into the heart of man what God has prepared for them that love it. He didn't make all these planets and universes for nothing. But you know, God is going to be pleased to have his little children go around and discover the stuff that he hid for them to discover. But you can't get it together because you got to have a boyfriend or a girlfriend and they're pulling you out of the church. Or you got to hold a grudge against somebody and can't forgive people. Why, God, don't just tell me how good it is. Because it's just like you. You don't want nobody to want you because you got money. Right. You want somebody to love you on the basis of a relationship. That's right. You ought to be glad when anybody walks away from you. That's right. One down, one to go. You just keep on. You could be wasting all your time with somebody that don't. That's just taking up time. Taking up time. Look at somebody say 15 summers, 20 summers, 30s. You ain't got forever to get it together. I'm preaching already, and y'all ain't really saying nothing. Anyway, mega churches cannibalize all the other churches. We know that, you know what cannibal is? It means you eat your own. All the little churches that don't have a coffee shop, Hebrews in the lobby, all the churches that don't have romper room and gym sets for the kids to play monkey bars. All the churches that don't have Walmart, like a Walmart Christian center, everything you need in every aisleway, and they choke out the small churches, and all of a sudden you got a big room with 10 to 20,000 people in there with low spiritual IQ. Can't pray, can't cast out devils, don't walk in the spirit, ain't led by the Holy Ghost, don't know nothing about who they are in Christ, just going to church, having a good time, and doing life together. Find a bunch of projects to do. Okay, you know, this is kind of like an apostolic type preaching message, so I'm sorry. Yeah, doing life together. And you know what? You get all them people together to get tired, so you have to come up with a bunch of stuff for them to do. We're going over to dig whales in Peru, whether they need them or not. We're going. We're going to get everybody together on a mission trip. It was like Christian safari. You get to go over there and take pictures. You ain't going nowhere where they're taking your heads and shrinking them and putting them around your neck. You ain't going nowhere where the gospel is not named. You ain't going nowhere where the gospel is not being preached. You're just going on nice trips somewhere, taking pictures with camels. I did a missions job. That's not mission work. The real missionaries I know face down witchcraft and face down warlocks and come against the kind of real warlocks and voodoo men that fly through the air and shape-shift into hyenas. See, you don't know nothing about that because you live in a comfortable place called America. And that's why we have this country going, the church going into a tailspin. Because once you get so popular, you create this big machine that you got to keep feeding and keep making money because you have all these employees, you're top heavy. So you got to keep coming up with something every week and keep coming up with something, getting people involved in busy work. But is anybody putting on Christ? Is anybody transforming their neighborhood? Is anybody getting their family saved? Is anybody demonstrating the power of God and learning how to be as he is? So are we in this world. The devil loves to get you involved in the next best thing to the will of God. Loves to get you involved in doing stuff. And I'm not knocking. There's some big churches that are doing some great works. But there's a whole lot of them that are none but personality cults. Preaching anything. And people, here's the problem I have with now. People don't know garbage when they hear it. Because they haven't heard enough of the truth to know what garbage is. The problem with the majority of Christians in America is that we become pigs instead of sheep. Sheep won't eat anything. They won't. Now, a goat will eat anything, but a sheep won't eat anything. A lamb won't eat anything. Pigs will eat. You know what's wrong with pigs? They will eat anything. They'll eat you if you fall down in there. You know why pigs? Do you know why pigs can eat anything?
because they don't have taste buds. They can eat rotten garbage because it's just all the same to them. They have no spirit. You know why some folks can just eat anything? Because they have no spiritual taste buds. They have no spiritual discernment. They don't know. They don't. You know, I could put some rubber and melt it on a piece of cardboard and tell you it's pizza. But your taste buds will soon tell you this ain't pizza. This ain't cheese. But if you have no taste buds, you can't tell the difference between styrofoam and bread. You understand what I'm saying? We're in a crucial time where right now the church is going to decide the course of this nation. Oh, they'll never overturn Roe versus Wade, which overturned it. Oh, this is never going to happen. This stuff is happening. That don't mean it's over. It means it's going back to the states the way it's supposed to. I know your pastor informs you and tell you this stuff. But we got people in the body of Christ that don't even know what they're supposed to believe about anything. They don't know they're making decisions that are going to affect generations of children. And God has called us to become restorers of the breach. You are the salt of the earth. I want you to turn to the book of St. John, 1 John 4:17. One little verse, and we're going to go there and go along with this. Members become lazy and complacent. Go into a big churches that do everything for you but shake your hands for you. And we're producing a generation that doesn't know power and doesn't know truth. I've had people tell me, we can't do services like you do because we got to be out in an hour and a half. We got an hour, 15 minutes, we got to be out. We want to get you for one. We want to get you on Sunday, can't get you to come back during the middle of the week. So you can't come and participate in believers' meetings where you learn how to flow in the Holy Ghost and you learn how to hear from God. So it's Sunday only, and then we got to have it an hour, 15 minutes because you got to go, and you got to go to golf, and you got to go other stuff and do other things. So what does that leave the Holy Ghost, and what does the Holy Ghost think about us when he goes over to Africa and they're in their service for 5 hours? He goes over to China, and they're willing to sit for 7 hours to hear the Word of God. And we wonder why our kids is dying, grandmother's dying before their time. We can't get miracles, tragedy happening. Because the measure that you meet, it will be measured back to you. Now, I'm not for no seven-hour service. I'm talking about you better be some blind eyes. I'm talking about eyeballs in sockets. It better be the lame walking. I want to see the glory cloud and experience it. I'm not just going to sit somewhere for 5 hours. Come on, say amen. If ain't nothing happening, dismiss. But Jesus came to his disciples at the point of his resurrection. He found them all in a stupor. After 3.5 years of the greatest display and manifestation of power that the earth has ever known, the Bible said if all the miracles that Jesus had done were to be written down, the world could not contain the volume of books that would be written. That means for 3.5 years, he was working miracles when he was sleeping. People was laying up next to him. They probably laying children down next to him. He's getting healed by the power of God that was present. Miracle constantly. And you wonder if he'll do a miracle for you. And for 3.5 years, he was nothing but a 7-Eleven for miracles. He came in there and saw them all sitting around. And he first thing he said to them, he said, fools. Now, it's rough when Jesus calls you a fool because you probably are one if he says it. He said, fools and slow of heart. Pay attention to that. Slow of heart. Heart is your spirit, your inner man. He says you slow internally. He says you are learning disability spiritually. You are on the short bus spiritually. You've been walking with me for 3.5 years, and you're still struggling with what the prophets have told you, and it's coming to pass right in front of you, and you're still sitting around here like the world has come to an end. And now I have to actually appear to you to show you that I'm alive when I told you I was going to rise up again. Fools, because you're easily tricked by your own emotions, and fools, because your heart is not calibrated to receive truth. There is such a thing as low IQ. There are people who have low IQs. Sometimes they can't help it. Sometimes they can't help it. But you can also have a spiritual low IQ. Some of the stuff that you learn that God has taught you, even at this ministry, when you try to share with other people, they just, what are you talking about? I just want to be saved. I'm just trying to do what God got. I'm just trying to get a husband, believe in God for my blessing. And you say, well, this is how you get it. Oh, how many of y'all ever encountered that when you share truth and revelation for people? They struggle to get it down. None of y'all? You need to expand your circle and do some evangelism. If you ain't encountering people, all you got to do is go around the Christian community. Most of them don't know nothing about the authority in Christ. They don't know who they are in Christ. They don't know what Jesus came and did. They don't know what he accomplished in Christ. They don't know who Christ is at the right hand. They don't know who would embody being an intercessor and high priest. They don't know what that means as relation to you and him as he's standing there representing you. He represents you and you represent him to other people. They don't understand any of these things. And you're supposed to. Amen. You're supposed to know them. And they struggle because their spiritual IQ is low. It's not to put them down, but see, your IQ increases as you hear the word of God and continue to hear. It takes faith to acclimate to these truths. Yeah. Amen. It took me a while. I had people come to my church and say, Pastor, I just knew it was anointed. I just kept on listening. I didn't understand what you was talking about. That's what you want to hear from a member when they tell you. You don't understand what I'm talking about. I'm trying to break it down as low as I can. I mean, my God. But because I'm talking spiritual truths, they could not. They didn't have the bandwidth or frequency to receive these truths. Because the modern day church wants to dumb down Christianity so much that you don't really know who Jesus is. All the preaching and theology that we do is the purpose of one thing, that you know Jesus personally, that you get filled with the Holy Ghost and learn to be led by him and know Jesus personally to the degree that you can say, I know what he'll do. When you know somebody, you know, anybody know anybody that you know what they'll do? You don't have to be there to, oh, who got there? Jumba? Oh, I already know what it went down and he got there. I already know because you know him, right? That's how it ought to be when you know Jesus. When you go into the hospital room, oh, I know Jesus. I didn't come in here looking for him. I brought him in here with me. We have to go as believers from the point of head knowledge to heart knowledge, from head knowing to heart knowing. This is why the Ephesian prayer, and I'm getting ready to preach. I feel it now. Hallelujah. The Ephesian prayer Paul prayed, the Apostle Paul prayed for the church. He said, I'm praying that the eyes of your understanding would be flooded with light, that you might know the things that have been freely given to you, that you might comprehend with all saints, every dimension, that you might understand the riches of his inheritance in you. That you get that. He said, I'm praying for you even now. He says that the spirit of wisdom and knowledge, that you might receive it, the spirit of wisdom and knowledge, seeing and knowing in the Holy Ghost. I'm praying that your eyes would be expanded, that light, revelation will flood the eyes of your spirit, that you begin to see. 1 John 4:17, here is our love made perfect. Because somebody say perfect love. That we may have boldness in the day of judgment. Here's the part. Because as he is, so are we in this world. Somebody say that. Say, so as he is, so are we. Not as he was, not as he's going to be, but as he is right now, so are we in this world. What is he right now? He was awesome when he walked the streets of Galilee. He was awesome in the four Gospels. But what is he now? Right now, he's seated at the right hand of power. Right now, he is seated in heavenly places far above. Everybody say far above. Far above principalities and powers and dominions and thrones and any other name that's named, his name is above it. He said, as he is, so are you. What does that mean? He said, as he is right now, he is Melchizedek. I know folks love to have, they have a love affair with the Old Testament and they love to talk about Levites, but we're not in Levites anymore. We don't have a Levitical priesthood. We have a Melchizedek priesthood. We have an eternal, intergalactic, universal priesthood that extends beyond the borders of earth up into the heavens of heaven. We have a eternal priesthood, the priesthood of Melchizedek. That is the one that speaks for God, to God, of God, through God, and by God. We are in that priesthood. Every one of you is a priest after the order of Melchizedek. You are a priest after the order of Melchizedek. You have the right to come boldly to the throne of grace and obtain help in the time of need. You have the legal right because your name has been changed. When you got born again, you became a family member, and the family name is Yeshua. The family name is Jesus, and right now, whatever you were before Christ, now your name is Jesus, and when you come before the throne recognizes Yeshua come to the throne. As he is, so are we. This is the key to unlimited power. This is the key to abiding in him, to realize that as he is, so am I. I'm not trying to be, it is. He said it, he made it possible when he raised me up with him and set me, Paul said, in heavenly places,
far above all principle. If you don't believe that, you'll never walk in it. You can't try it. It won't work. Paul, I know, the devils were getting cast out, and the man, they was trying to cast him out. The devil said, wait a minute, wait a minute. He said, Paul, I know. Read it in the book of Acts. He said, Jesus, I know, but who are you? Who are you to wield this kind of authority over me? You're not connected to no family. You ain't connected to royalty. Your name ain't on the list of people I got to listen to. And the Bible says he leapt on them and beat their clothes off. The devil knew who Paul was. It wasn't so much that he knew who he said, Jesus I know and Paul I know. What he was trying to say is Jesus and Paul are on the same team. Jesus is affiliated with Paul, but you have no affiliation. You have no authority here. We're going to see an increase of demonic possessions in America. All this transgenderism and confusion and sexual immorality and all this nonsense, these people need the devil cast out of them. We're going to see people with the real extravagant displays of demonic power. And I'm praying they go right up in some of these mega churches where you're comfortable in not talking about the Holy Ghost and comfortable with not telling your people that they need to be baptized in the Spirit, not telling your people that they need to be filled with the Holy Ghost and they need to know how to pray in the name of Jesus and walk in their authority. I want them to go right up in there and shut Sunday morning services down because their pastors have opted out of a full gospel ministry. They've opted out of having a Pentecostal experience. They've opted out of preaching with power and authority because they don't think they have to deal with devils. Just because now over in other countries, they got devils that shapeshift, they got devils that do all kind of stuff, and it's real. All you gotta do is go overseas and you'll see it. They know it's real. But in America, we've been insulated with education and higher learning. We have everything with business. We have so much stuff. You don't have no idea how much America is protecting you from, because we have so much of the gospel being preached here freely that is buffeting what the spirit of the enemy wants to do. But when that veil gets lifted, as America keeps on moving away from God and the veil keeps on going, the devil is going to get America to be in the place that it wants to be in, where he can have liberty to oppress and drive people insane. But somebody say, oh, that's going to be terrible. It will be terrible. But I believe that sometime when you have lights on, people can't distinguish light. But until all the lights go out and there's a lone candle in the light, then you can see that light. See, the church has been shrouded with so much things that look like light and look like truth. But when the lights go out, only the true light is going to shine. Only those churches that have the Holy Ghost, only those men of God that walk in the power of God will be able to take authority. That's all right. Let the clouds gather. Let it get dark, because the greatest hour of the church in America is right before us. I wish I had somebody that believed it. Shout hallelujah. Authority flows from the top. If you're not under authority, you don't have authority. You don't just have authority because you think you're somebody. You have to be under. The cops don't have authority by themselves. They got to be under authority. They have exousia, which is authority. But they also have dunamis power. You'd think they don't. That gun is dunamis. Authority and power. And if you get fighting them, they'll get back up with more dunamis. You have to have authority. You have to be under authority. The Bible says, submit to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee. But guess what? If you ain't submitted to God, you can resist the devil all you want. He'll be in your house doing cartwheels and flips and drinking Kool-Aid. He ain't going to go nowhere until you submit to God. God is not going to let you live your life any way you. I don't know if you know this or not, but when you got saved, your life was over. You gave your life to Jesus. He became the Lord over your life. You might say, I don't want that. But see, I don't know about you, but he's a good God. I want him to be in charge of me. I want my body to be his body, because when my body is his body, it's his business to heal me from cancer, because this is his body. When my home is his home, it's none of my business how I'm going to pay my bills. That's his business now. I have a master. I have a Lord. It's none of my business how I'm going to eat. That's his problem now. It's none of my business how my children going to get healed. That's his children. That's his business. When you are all his, he is all yours. But you're dealing with somebody who's not going to be second fiddle. He's not going to take place for anybody else. He only knows how to be first. He don't know how to be second to everything else you do.
I'm going to tell you something. It's not always easy to transition to living for God, to give up old ways, especially when you made money selling dope and now you can't sell dope no more. It's difficult. But if you pass that first test, God will bless you. But see, sometimes many people can't leave their old lifestyles because they can't, with the eye of faith, trust that God's going to take care of me now. The rich young ruler, he said, I'll take you off your job and bring you with me. All these other fellas left their job. I'm taking care of all of them. Just give up everything you have so your soul dependency would be on me. He said, I can't give you that kind of control because I got great possessions. Huh? Well, you won't be the 13th disciple then. We would have had 13 disciples instead of 12. God was real when he made him the offer, but Jesus also knew that there's nothing wrong with having money. It's when money has you. That's the problem, because money becomes an idol.
Oh, yeah, you in here today. Sorry.
That's why money can't have a hold of you like that. When money has a hold on you, you don't like to give. Did you know that giving is the key to hearing from God clearly? Did you know that? You know why?
Well, how do you say that?
Because the voice of God is love. When you're stingy, I already know you can't hear from God. When you're selfish, I already know you don't hear from God accurately. Because God doesn't deal with people who are stingy. God deals with people who are like him. He's generous. God so loved the world that he... Giving is the action that defines love. I don't care how much you talk about how you love me. What are you giving to me? What are you doing? Love ain't a word. It's an action. Love is only defined by action. I love you so much. Well, prove it. What are you giving? What are you supplying? Love is sacrifice. Anybody you can love and ain't no sacrificing involved, and y'all wonder if you love them or not. Let me tell you something. Children are an inconvenience. Let's be truthful. The first 5 years, your life is over, Jack. You're going to be taking care of baby. Baby going to be the boss without trying to cry. You got to go run. 3 o'clock in the morning, bottle runs. Come on, somebody. This is an inconvenience. You can't even watch a show. They screaming and hollering. They need constant attention, constantly. That's why when they get older and they start talking back to you, you want to wring their neck. Do you know what I gave up for you? I gave up 5 nights in Aruba for you. 3 years in a row, I gave up Hawaii. Do you know what I will do to you? No, you ain't marrying him.
I'm going to do it.
After all, nobody will break your heart like children. Because you give up your whole life to give him everything. If you worth a dime, you do. And nothing hurts more than when they turn on you and start getting rebellious. And what did I do to you? It is the ultimate betrayal. Are you listening? But it's a sacrifice. You do it because you love them. And truthfully, they didn't ask to be here. You brought them here. You and Luther Vandross brought them here. They didn't ask to be here. You brought them in here, and now they're here. And God says, take care of them, children. So you give to them because you sacrifice that they can have things. Love is sacrifice. Your husband, your wife, you sacrifice. You take down things you want to complete them. If you're not ready to sacrifice and share, you ain't ready for marriage. A lot of people want to be married, but they ain't marriage material. Marriage is sacrifice. It's giving up. It's giving up stuff. I wanted it this way, but I got to be with you. You wanted it the other way. You got to make compromises. You can't be inflexible and be with nobody. You got two different cultures. Come on, somebody. Everybody has a personal culture. You got two different cultures trying to blend in one house. She's a morning person and you a night owl. Come on. You got all this stuff going on. You like toilet paper under. She likes it up. You got all these conflicts going on. You say, well, that's nothing. But add them up times 29,000. Blessed are the flexible, for they shall not be bent out of shape. You ain't ready to be with nobody if you selfish. You got to be your way to the highway. It ain't going to work. You can't just do stuff to people because you want them to get it. Because you want this later, you're going to do this now. That's a trading center. That ain't marriage. That's transactions. Marriage is not 50-50. Marriage is 100-100. Love is sacrifice. God so loved the world that he gave up something that was valuable in heaven. He sacrificed something valuable You know, the most valuable thing in heaven is the word of God. He upholds all things by the word of his power. The word of God creates moon, stars, galaxies. The word of God creates gold, water. It is the all-purpose creation engine, the engine of creation. For God so loved the world, he gave up the backbone of the economy of heaven, wrapped it in flesh and sent to the earth. How much kind of love? Oh, what manner of love is this that God would call us the sons of God? God gave up heaven's most valuable resource to redeem mankind. When you love, you give. God's going to challenge you to give something extravagant one day. And it's going to be the very test of your faith. Are you listening? Because if you can't hear, see, it's easy when God starts nudging you to give something. I ain't just talking about in church. I'm talking about to other people to be a giver. When God is leading you through love to be touched, to give to somebody, that's a way of hearing his voice. If you can learn to hear through giving, he's training you to hear who not to marry, what to invest in, where not to move to. Because you learn through the frequency of using that same leading of giving. You learn to get used to that voice. The same thing that told me to give $100 to Sister So-and-so is the same feeling telling me not to go nowhere with you. But when you all stopped up and hurt everybody and took stuff from you and you damaged and abused and you just can't give no more, I just can't take it no more. When you get to that kind of spirit locked up, you get to a place where you can't hear from God. You need a prophet to come prophesy to you because you don't trust your own feelings no more. You don't know if it's God or not. If you don't learn to be a giver, see, you stop making a living and learn how to make a giving. God is looking for generous people because he's generous. You know, the church is supposed to be so knit that when we praying, God can bring people to you that have needs without them having to come ask you. You already know, God told me to give you $100. God told me to drop this money. God told me I had something. Do you need this? See, that's the playground for the gifts of the Spirit. See, if you can't qualify in love, he said, wait a minute. He says, all these gifts of the Spirit in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, he said, covet earnestly the best gifts. He said, desire the best gifts. But I'm going to show you a better way than just lusting and wanting to be a prophet. Desiring to be have a word. I'm going to show you a better way to empower your gift. He said, love. Love is the qualifier for the power of God. Love is the qualifier. When you love so much that you'll get on your face and you'll pray and labor in prayer on somebody else's behalf, and you ain't getting nothing out of it, we disqualify ourselves from the greater glory because we don't have the bond of love. We get offended. We fall out. We get mad at people. I grew up in a family, I'm almost done preaching. I grew up in a family of 10. I'm the youngest of 10, 8 boys and 2 girls. It wasn't nothing but testosterone in my house everywhere. My daddy was an alpha male. All these folk in the house, you learn to, it was a lot of fighting going on. Fighting and bucking. My father come in and said, I'm going to beat everybody if you don't stop fighting. And you done got into a fight with somebody and you really want to push them down the stairs and hope they break their neck, you're so mad at them. Because can't nobody hurt you like people that live with you. Can't nobody hurt you like people who close to you. And so we had all these rooms. We had 4 bedrooms and 8 kids. Somebody had to double up. I remember being in a room with 3 people in the room. My brother here and my other brother next to me. And you mad with them and got to go to bed with them. Sleeping with anger. You learn that the night changes a lot of things. You sleep it off, you get up, and you realize that's the way it is. And the next time you look up, you're fighting for that brother that you were fighting against somebody else. You learn like a family to forgive each other. You weak that every time you get offended at what he say or what they say or somebody, I'm leaving the church. You ain't leaving the club because somebody made you mad. You didn't stop going to the restaurant because somebody made you mad. All I can't get help in here. But we ready to get rid of the church because somebody hurt my feelings. I'm church hurt. You ain't church hurt. Jesus didn't do anything to you. We take out on Jesus what his stupid children do to us. Oh, and whether you know it or not, all that stuff is a test to you because God is watching all of it. God is testing them how they treat you, and he's testing you on how you react to how they treat you. He's why he's getting something. He's moving his thing along. Love. If you can't hear in giving, you probably won't be able to hear on the most important things in life you want answers for. Because faith worketh by love. You can't even have faith until the love of God is working at you. And I admit, it's hard to believe that a man that lived 2,000 years ago that you've never seen died for you, and that means anything to you. That's difficult. It takes faith. It takes a supernatural act of God, the foolishness of preaching. As you heard the word, you were convicted in your heart, and you believed it. And people look at you, you believe that? Are you crazy? You ain't never seen Jesus? That's a supernatural operation. Well, it's so cool. See, we want everything supernatural to be spectacular, but sometimes the things that have spiritual are not spectacular. Sometimes they walk right past you. You didn't even notice it. It's seamless the way it happens sometimes. The supernatural is not always spectacular. You miss the supernatural looking for the spectacular. It's not always spectacular. Because when you're born again, the supernatural is supposed to be a way of life for you. It's supposed to be second nature. It's supposed to be. And as we walk in love and walk in the presence of God and walk in trying to please God, the devil's going to make sure the right amount of people come along to offend you. He's going, have you noticed something about offenses? A lot of times you ain't had nothing to do with them. You was walking along monument and somebody do something stupid and now you're ready to poke them in the eye. You're ready to get mad now. You'd have been all right if you hadn't ran into so-and-so that day. Yeah. Or if somebody didn't choose to abuse you or do you wrong and put this thing in you that you have to deal with now. Are you understanding it? But offenses will block the power of God in you. There's few things that will stop you from getting healed, but unforgiveness is a major one. Because God says, I dropped the charges and forgave you of everything. You ought to just drop the charges and forgive them too. But when you don't have a revelation of what he's forgiven you, here's the thing. Not only is it hard to believe in Jesus without the supernatural power of God, the conviction of the Holy Ghost, it's hard to believe that he really loved you. It's the hardest thing in the world to believe that this mighty God actually is concerned about your welfare, whether you're eating and sleeping, whether you're loving right, whether you have this. He cares. It's hard to believe this because so many things happen in life that seem to contradict. How can I have a God that's in love with me the way I know love? And this is happening. Yeah. The greatest revelation you can have is to know that I am loved by God. Right. I'm loved, and he ain't going to let me fail. He ain't going to let me die. He's not going to let this overtake me. If he let it happen, then he must have a plan of escape for me. Ultimately, trust in God. The purpose of all this is that you might know him. Are you listening? Luke chapter 7, verse number 10, he says, and a certain centurion servant who was dear to him was sick and ready to die. A certain centurion. And when he heard of Jesus, he was sent to the elders of the Jews, beseeching him that he should come and heal his servant. The elders of the Jews, as if they had anything to do with whether Jesus was going to heal or not. And when he came to Jesus, he besought him instantly, saying that he was worthy, that he wasn't worthy for him that he should do this. This man was concerned about whether he was worthy enough for Jesus to help him. And he says, and Jesus said to him, verse number 6, and when he was now not far from the house, the centurion sent friends to him, saying, Lord, trouble not thyself, for I am not worthy that you shouldest enter under my roof. Wherefore, neither thought I myself worthy to come to you, but say in a word, and my servant shall be healed. For I am a man set under authority, having under me soldiers, and I say unto the one, go, and he goes. I say to another, come, and he comes. And to my servant, do this, and he doeth it. And when Jesus heard these things, he marveled at him and turned about and said unto the people that followed him, I say unto you, I have not found such a great faith, no, not in Israel. Among none of the sons of Abraham, it took a centurion for the Roman army to have this kind of faith. And then they were sent, returned to the house, found the servant whole that had been sick. You think the centurion was standing there talking to Jesus, but it was not. It was men he sent to talk to Jesus. He didn't think he was worthy to talk to Jesus. He questioned whether he was qualified to have a miracle. He wondered if he qualified for a miracle for someone else under his authority. You had to understand the flow of authority. Now, what he did, he said, I know Jesus. I've heard a lot about Jesus. One thing we know about Jesus so far is that he got power. We've heard the testimonies of healing and miracles, and I've heard about it. And what I'm saying is, I don't know. I sent to the leaders of the Jewish people, the elders, to ask them, can I get a miracle from Jesus? And they didn't know because Jesus ain't hanging and rolling with them. They don't have no control. They didn't have no favor or enrolled with Jesus. They couldn't guarantee a meeting with Jesus. Y'all ain't gonna help me up in here because they didn't have him, but Jesus was unto himself. And so the centurion sends people from the house and says, hey, I'm not worthy for you to come to my house. My house is unclean. You are clean. But I want, see, the humility is the precedence of authority. We don't need people that want to walk in authority without humility.
Because if all authority and new humility, you will be an overlord. You will abuse people. It takes kindness and gentleness to walk in authority. And he says, listen, he says, I don't know you, Jesus, but I know you got authority in another realm. Because the things that you talk to, they respond to. I heard about you talking to the wind and it obeyed you. I heard about you walking into leper colonies and cleansing the lepers. I heard about you stopping funerals and speaking to dead people and they get up. I understand speaking power. I understand calling authority. You see, in the Garden of Eden, I feel the Holy Ghost. When in the Garden of Eden, when Adam fell in sin and he received the injection of that vile contaminant, his DNA was contaminated, and now his spiritual DNA matched his body DNA matched his spiritual DNA. When his spirit fell, so did his body fell, and his body began to die, and now his spiritual DNA, which is his identity, was corrupted, and now he went to talk to the trees and to the animals and they did no longer obey him. The greatest loss in the Garden of Eden is Adam lost his calling power. He couldn't call the animals anymore. He couldn't command the animals. Why? Because now his DNA, that's the highest form of security right now, is eye retina scans and fingerprint. Because the men are only catching up to what God has been doing for 2,000 and thousands of years. It's your identity-based, come on, security system. And see, because his DNA was lost in that contamination of sin, everybody that was born out of Adam was born with the birth defect of sin, born with that defect of being out of fellowship with God. Come on, somebody. Their DNA had been altered. No wonder the lions didn't listen to bears. First, Adam was calling the bears and the lions. Now the lions was chasing Adam. Come on, because he didn't have no authority anymore, because he couldn't pass security clearance. His voice, come on, his voice print didn't past security clearance, and the tree said, I ain't got to listen to you. Thorns came up instead of fruit. He lost his position. He lost his calling power. Look at somebody and say, he lost his calling power. Because when God created Adam, he made him a living spirit. He made him, one translation says, a talking spirit. That's the difference between him and the animals. Animals don't have the ability to talk. Parrots can sound like it, but they really can't talk with language. Only mankind can talk to things and respond to things with a language that comes from breath and life out of your spirit. But when Adam's spirit was contaminated with sin, come on somebody, his DNA was remade over, and now nothing responds to him, and he's locked out of the system that God built for him. He's locked out of the house and out of the planet that God built for him. And everybody that came out of him now are born with the same genetic defect, that their DNA no longer matches the superior DNA of God. And that's why God said, I got to go down here and redeem them. I got to use my DNA. Come on, that's why you got to use blood. That's why his blood had to be shed, his DNA. Come on, somebody, because there's life in the blood. Jesus said, I'm going to be born. He said, I'm going to send you into the earth, but you got to be born outside of the union of a man, because the curse is passed over through the man. So therefore, get me a virgin, and I'm going to overshadow her and my blood. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God, and in him was life, and that life is the light that lit up every man. Come on, he was in the world, and the world was made by him. He came unto his own, and they received him not, but as many as received him. As many as received him. He didn't say as many as believed on him. He said as many as received him. When you're receiving something, that means you're taking part of something. Something is entering into you, an injection. He said as many as received his injection of DNA have become the sons of God. Christianity is not about not going to heaven or going to hell and not going to heaven. Christianity is not about being a better person. Christianity is not about doing good deeds. And hopefully your good deeds outweigh your bad. Christianity is about transformation. Christianity is about that you might become a son, that you might be reborn again with a new nature that comes from the Son of God. That's what Christianity is. Putting on sonship. Adam lost his power to call. He lost his authority to speak. But here comes Jesus. Born of a virgin. You thought that was good for nursery rhyme. He had to be born of a virgin because the blood comes from the daddy. That's why Maury Povich's show was going on so long, because he could get blood tests. You is the daddy. God knew the blood came from the Father 2,000 years ago in that book. He said, the Holy Ghost is going to overshadow you. And the thing that you're going to have, this holy thing, shall be called Emmanuel, God with us. The light of God slowed down from light speed emanating and congealed into liquid and came into the body of a woman. Congealed liquid light is what the blood of Jesus is. Liquid light flowing. And in that light, your blood carries blueprints and your blood carries design. That's why you got brown eyes and brown hair. That's why your feet are bigger than your sister's. Come on. That's why stuff happens, because it's in the DNA. Come on. It's in the little blueprints. In the beginning, see, one translation says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word is Logos. The word Logos means blueprint. The word Logos means design. In the beginning was the designer, and the designer was with God, and the designer was God. The original blueprint. See, God has original intention towards you. There's a way that he originally wanted things to happen, but sin came and knocked it out of whack. So when you see Jesus in operation, you see God's original intention towards you. Yes, I will come and heal her at once. Yes, I will do this. Yes, he never told anybody no. When you see Jesus, you see the Word of God in action. Hallelujah. Adam lost his ability to speak to things, and he had to use his hands to work and toil for everything. It went from mouth to hand. The greatest gift that God gave mankind was his imagination. Aren't you glad that sharks don't have imagination? Aren't you glad lions don't set traps for humans? You walking along, bloom, and lions come in, and they come in there, and they caught you again. Aren't you glad that snakes don't have an imagination when you're running from them? They don't invent anything. Only man invent. Men, because of imagination, are able to conquer every animal. I'm going to lead that dummy into a trap, and we're going to have shark steak tonight. Through his imagination, he conquered dinosaurs. Through his imagination, he's learned how to beat the laws of gravity and fly around the world. Through his imagination. That's the gift that God gave men. That's why the devil spends so much time corrupting imagination. That's what distinguishes you between animals, is that you can imagine. You can come up with a solution if you can image it. The Bible says, I'm going another way. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. It's the evidence of things not seen. What does that mean? Faith is the substance of things hoped for. What does hope have to do with anything? Hope always has to do with the future. If it was here, you wouldn't have to hope for it. Hope is always in the future, and hope has to do with the imagination, because if you can't see it, it ain't here in reality, then how are you hoping for something? Because you have to imagine it inside. You have to see this and say, I hope that can happen. But see, faith is the supernatural energy of Jesus that enters the image and brings life to it. Faith is the supernatural energy of God that enters into the image and brings it alive. It brings the future into the present. That's why it's important on what's building the imagines in your eye, in your body, in your life. What are you imagining? Are you using your past, your hurts, your pains, what they did to you? Or are you using the Word of God as the template for your imagination? Because here's the thing about it. The power of God can never overshadow anything that doesn't look like him. Let me tell you something. The image of God is the only thing that can capture the power of God. When God wants to do something, he never looks for me. He looks for whoever he can find himself in. That's who he looks for. He ain't looking for you. He's looking for himself in you. He's looking for his image in him. Because as he speaks, the Word of God is going to, the Holy Ghost overshadows the Word of God to bring it to pass. So what images are ruling your internal thought life? Faith is the substance of things imagined about. That's why all of Satan's warfare is in the mind. The weapons of warfare are not carnal. They're not of the flesh. They're what? Mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, imaginations, and high things. All of those are in the thought realm. Strongholds in the thought realm. Do you know they say a bull elephant, when they throw it around, a rope around his neck, and they put it onto a pole, he won't move. You know why he won't move? This big elephant that can turn over cars. All he got to do is reach over there and pull that thing and snatch it up the ground, and he's gone.
You know why he don't do nothing? Because when he was a little baby elephant, they put his neck around, they put it around a rope around his neck, and they tied it to a post, and he couldn't pull it. And for days and years, he couldn't pull it. So it's set up in his mind that there's no way I can get free. So now that he's old, it's already set up in his mind that he just put it around and he ain't going nowhere because he didn't try it 1,000 times and it's never worked. The image of defeat is in him. What has the devil been putting in your head for defeat? What images from your childhood, my mama, my daddy, my cousin, my mom, what images have he been working overtime that you filter everything in your world through those images? Faith is the substance of things imagined about. The Bible says, can I throw this fastball at you? Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen, correct? The title, one translation says that it's the title deed of possession. I might own a house in Michigan, but I moved to Atlanta, but I still own a house in Michigan, and I let somebody else do my representation, but I got to sign the papers. It's still my house. I have authority over and own it. I don't even have to see you. You see my house in Detroit, and you want to buy it. You go make the necessary, bring the money, the earnest money, down payment. You go through the whole process. All I got to do is get documents, and all I got to do is sign it and send it back to you. I ain't never met you, ain't never seen you, but I know I got property in another realm. I got the title deed of possession. I ain't got to see the house. Let's say this, go even further. Your grandmother left you a house in Podunk, Mississippi. You ain't going down there. Somebody assessed the value and said it's worth $20,000. Wow. $20,000. Thanks, Grandma. I ain't going down there, and I ain't living there, though. I've never seen the property, but I got the title deed of possession. Anybody want to do business there with me, got to deal business with me in where I'm at, because I ain't coming there. I ain't never seen the house. Never walked in the house, but it's mine by title deed of possession. And I can make a transaction and get the money and trade something I ain't never seen. Faith is the title deed of possession. I got the title deed, even though I can't see it. It's still just as much mine as if I was walking in it and living in it. Faith is the substance of it. Faith is the title deed of possession. Faith is the materiality. That's what it means, substance. That means it's something I can put my hands on. It is the material part that represents the part that I can't see. Faith is the seen that represents the unknown. And see, we're trying to have faith because we want to believe, but you're struggling because you can't imagine it right. Because you're trying to deal with something unknown and you ain't seen it, but you're used to being used in your sight. We walk by faith, and what's the opposite of faith? Sight is the opposite of faith, not fear. Fear is a bastardization of faith. Fear is the negative energy. Faith is the super positive energy. Faith is actually Jesus. He is the person of faith. I'm going to explain it to you. Y'all like this so far? So how do you change your images? Faith is the substance of things imagined about. It's the title deed of possession of things I can't see. So in the beginning, so faith cometh by and hearing two times. Faith come by hearing and hearing. So I got to do twice as much hearing of the word for faith to come. Not faith don't come by what I've heard or words I heard last year. I'm believing God for my healing because I read the scripture last year. No, you got to read it again. Faith come by hearing and hearing. Every new challenge needs a new dose of imagery. Because you got healed of cancer 10 years ago. It's time for you getting the word again to get healed again if it tries to come back. Faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. So faith is a byproduct of the word of God. Because you can't have faith without the word of God. Do you not know you can't have faith beyond your revealed knowledge of the word of God? You can't have faith beyond your knowledge of the word of God. If you don't believe God will do it, or you ain't ever heard he does it, and you ain't got no promise, you can't believe for it. You just hoping and wishing. Faith is not hoping. Faith is saying, you said it, you got to do it based upon who you said you are. You said you ain't a liar, so I'm not going to sit up all night worrying about this. You said it, either you going to do it or you ain't going to do it. And I ain't got an attitude because I'm going to praise you all through the night. I'm going to offer up a sacrifice as a true Melchizedek priest because I know it's already done. So I ain't going to wait for the battle. I ain't going to wait for the manifestation. I'm going to shout now. I'm going to act like it's already done because it's already done because I hold the title deed of possession already. You can't worship God and you're full of doubt and fear.
When you worship God, that's your faith being expressed. You don't worship God because God needs to hear your tired singing. God ain't impressed by you singing. God ain't got low self-esteem that he needs millions of people to say how much they love him. Worship is for you. It ain't for him. You don't want to forget that he's holy. You don't want to forget he can't be stopped. You don't want to forget he's invincible. You're the one that forgets that he's high and lifted up. That's why you have to sing it, because as you, whatever you worship, that's what you become like. Worship is a tool. Worship is a technology, a spiritual technology. Am I going too far? Faith is substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Faith is a byproduct of hearing the word. So I can say the word of God is the substance of things hoped for. I can say the word of God is the title deed of my possession. So if I got a promise, I got it. If I have the word of God, I got it. I don't have to see it. He said it. It's true. I got it. Faith is substance, and faith can only come from the word. So really, let's go back to the original source. The word of God is the substance of things that I'm imagining. I'm imagining stuff based upon what he said. He said, I can have this, so I'm imagining it. I'm seeing it with my spiritual eye. Are you following? Say amen if you hear it. So, if the word of God is the substance of things hoped for, and it's my title deed of possession of things I can't see, the word. So if I got the word for it, I got it. See, many people are trying to believe God and they ain't got no word for what they're believing for. I ask people, Pastor, I'm believing God for so-and-so. What scriptures you standing on? Oh, I just know God. No, that's not going to work. Because all the contradicting evidence that's getting ready to be thrown up in front of you by Satan is not going to overcome. You need to have the word against that. You got to have the word. What promises are? There's 20,000 promises in the Bible concerning your life, health, money, finances, children. Do you know any of them? Then you better search the scriptures and see that you find eternal life. But see, we lazy. We don't want to search it. That's part of the process that's going to bring you faith, is as you search the word, as you keep on hearing it. But you want to skip the process because we like to skip everything in the day. So if the word of God is the substance of things hoped for, anybody say the word of God is the substance of things I'm imagining. It's the title deed of possession of the things I can't see. So if the word of God is, then who is the word of God? In the beginning was the word was with God, the word was. So I could actually take out the word of God and say, Jesus is the substance of things I'm imagining, and he is my title deed of possession. So I got Jesus. I know I got Jesus. So Jesus now is the assurance. He is the assurance and the insurance that I have the thing that I'm hoping for, because it's based upon a promise that he made. So I'm not trying to have faith. I'm rejoicing in faith. I ain't trying to believe God. Come on. The word of God has come upon me, and now the word is wearing me. I ain't wearing it. Come on. He's put me on like a coat. The word of God now is the substance of things hoped for. The question all comes down to is, who is Jesus? Who do men say that I am? You are, some say you John the Baptist, some say you Elijah, but who do you say? You are the Christ, the Son of the Living. Hush your mouth. Flesh and blood didn't reveal that to you. Flesh and blood didn't tell you that. You didn't get that from earth. You didn't get that from this realm. A heavenly revelation came to you. Faith is a revelation that comes to you supernaturally as you hear the word of God. I hope y'all are getting this. We think we in faith often and we're not. But it comes down to what you think about Jesus. Life is based upon conclusions you have. You have concluded if you have this amount of money, you can buy that car. It's a conclusion. You have concluded if you go to sleep tonight, you won't be tired in the morning, hopefully. Sometimes you do because you toss and turn and all kind of stuff. Nevertheless, you got the picture. What conclusions have you come to about Jesus? What conclusion have you come to about healing? Well, I know God can. He can do anything. That's not a conclusion. I mean, that's a conclusion, but it's not complete enough to believe what he'll do it for you. We know God can do anything, but will he do it right now? Will he do it for you right now? What do you have to base on? What knowledge of Jesus? See, as you grow in the knowledge of Jesus, he is the doorway to access everything in his kingdom. He said, I am the door. He says, I set before you a door.
that no man can shut. So he says, according to the measure that you meet, it's going to be measured back to you. So if you don't like the way your door is swinging, what are you giving to, what are you pushing? How much are you exerting to get that door open? Because it's only going to come to you at the speed that you encounter it. This man said to Jesus, I'm a man under authority. I'm not here in person. You don't know me. You ain't seen my face. Unknown. See, sometime God is so good. He's given us a language that we speak in unknown tongues because we're touching an unknown realm. And an unknown language pulls unknown things out of that realm. Secrets passing. See, you neglect your prayer life. Bible says building up your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. You neglect praying in the Spirit. And then you don't hear the word but once a week. And the devil comes with challenges and knocks you right off your square. Does this make sense? I see the gears rolling in people's heads like this. Like, wait a minute. Your IQ is high enough. You getting this. He came to him and said, I'm not here in person. I sent my representatives. When you see them, you see me. Because I'm under authority. I'm under the emperor of Rome. And death is the penalty if they disobey me. They're going to do what I say. I don't run to the back of the room to tell somebody something. I call them to me and they come. I tell you to go and they go. I tell them to come. He says, I understand how authority works. It's through words, talking, speaking, calling. I understand. I understand how power works. I understand authority. Now, the Jewish people, they've been oppressed. They don't understand authority. They struggle with power. All they know is they want a Messiah to overthrow Rome and put them back at the head of things. That's why they got rid of Jesus, because he wasn't promising to overthrow Rome. They wanted to be restored back to being the head, not the tail, above and not beneath. They wanted to do it without obeying God, though, like so many other people do. And when they found out that Jesus was not going to overthrow Rome, he was not going to reestablish the kingdom of Israel, they said, give us Barabbas. Kill him. Tell him God, send us another one, because this ain't going to work. And they didn't know he was God in the flesh. They just thought he was an anointed man. And if this one don't work, then get us another one. That's why Judas betrayed him. Judas wanted a revolution. He wanted a revolution. Like a lot of people today be hollering about a revolution. He wanted to overthrow the kingdom. We're going to be oppressed. We put us back where we belong. And he saw that Jesus wasn't going to do none of that. He said, sir, 30 pieces of silver. I'll tell you where to pick him up at. He was holding the money person, holding the money bag for Jesus. He was the biggest devil in the whole group, had the money. And Jesus knew everything, so he gave it to him anyway. And it like the Lord. I know you're bad, so I'm going to give this to you so you can build a case against yourself. So when I get through when judgment comes, there won't be nobody saying you got judged unfairly. Hold the money back. Because it's going to reveal who you are. Now you got two choices. You can do right or you can do wrong. But I'm banking on your nature to come through. You think Jesus didn't know he was stealing money and taking stuff out of the bag? The Lord will often give you something to challenge your character so that your true character can be revealed. And the question is whether you'll deal with it or not. Or you get mad and lead a church and get mad at gospel and Christianity and join the black Hebrew Israelites or something else stupid. That's a bunch of foolishness people are getting swept up into. It just means that people are following people who are dumb and don't know the Bible themselves. Yeah. You know the truth and nobody can fool you with that stuff. Get out of here. You know, brother, you're of the tribe of Judah. How do you know you're of the tribe? Even the white folks that claim to be Jews don't know what tribe they are. How do you know that? All the records was destroyed in the temple. How do you know something that nobody else knows? You don't even know who your grandfather is, basically. You don't tell me you came from what tribe. Is that right? You don't even know what side of the family you got on. Come on. And you're going to tell me you can trace your roots back to Israel. Are you stupid? Well, I'm a Hebrew. I said, that's good. I said, you 2,000 years too late for that to mean anything. Because today it's the chosen people, is the church. Well, I was chosen in Abraham. I was chosen before the foundation of the world. In him. That's the sidebar. I'm meddling now. I'm closing in. Can I get 7 minutes? Okay. I ain't gonna keep y'all mad at me. I'm gonna keep you here long enough just for the Baptists to get through at the buffet. You can get there at Golden Corral right on time. He says, I got authority. I speak and it happens. Because I'm under authority. They do what I tell them.
He says, you don't got to come to my house because game, no game. Power, no power. He wasn't saved. He didn't have no Holy Ghost. He didn't have no deep revelation. He wasn't sitting under a rabbi, but he understood a truth about authority, and all truth is parallel. He understood authority in the natural realm. He says, look, I heard about all the stuff you do. You must have that kind of authority in the spiritual realm. See how smart this guy was? He was doing the math in his head, and nobody was telling him. I know how authority works. I know how power works, and I call. I don't have to. He ain't got to even come to my house. Go tell my servants to tell him to speak the word. It'll be done. See, remember I told you last time I was here, your revelation is the jurisdiction of your faith. Turn to somebody and tell them, your revelation is the jurisdiction of your faith. Low revelation, low faith. Low revelation, low authority. You can't move boldly in something you don't even know is yours. You can't tell the devil to get out your house and you don't know if he will listen to you or not. Because you've been full of Hollywood movies where the priest be rebuking the devil and he be growing three heads while he's talking to him. Getting worse, like the word of God don't work. That's Hollywood. Demons tremble at the name of Jesus. They remember the defeat that he served them as he conquered them and triumphed. The Bible says, in the words that he triumphed over them, that means he drug them all around the spiritual realm in front of everybody, let everybody see he defeated them, and put his head on them and said, they're done, it's over. All power in heaven and earth is in my hand. All of it, not some of it, all of it. If Jesus got all power, somebody ain't got none. You can't have all power, but he got power. No, the devil has miraculous powers of supernatural power, but he ain't got authority unless you give it to him. By listening to him and believing what he say and being deceived by him. Then he has power, because whom you yield your members to obey, they have authority over you. And Jesus says, Jesus is tripping. He marveled. Do you know what marvel mean? Marvel's like, whoa. Jesus has said, I've been talking to these people and I haven't found this kind of faith in all the synagogues. In all the gatherings of people that's supposed to be covenant people that know God, ain't none of them got faith. Only outside of the kingdom of Israel do I find authority in Rome. This is deep. You go tell your servant. You go tell your master. His servant is. Wait, the Bible says as he was walking, he didn't even stop walking. He said, go tell him. He was listening. They were walking behind him, telling him. Jesus didn't even turn around. He said, you go tell him that it's done. And kept on going. That's my Jesus. He spoke the word. Oh, you don't understand. The same word that came out of the Father that traveled through darkness and began to cough up quasars and nebulas and moons and designing galaxies. He was designing stars and moons and planets and water. He was designing stuff in nanoseconds. And he was spitting it out and speaking it. Oh, can you imagine? In the beginning was the word. This word was created. The all creative power of God is his word. And this word liquefied and came in flesh. No wonder the blood, no wonder the energy was not radioactive. Come on, somebody in here. It was a wonder it wasn't radioactive. It was inert active. It couldn't kill you. It couldn't hurt you. But if you laid next to him and touched him, come on, power would go out and he could recreate arms and eyes. You know why? Because the blueprint of how eyes were created were in his bloodstream. The blueprint, the DNA of arms and legs and body parts and kidneys and livers, all that stuff was in him, was life. Was the very detail of every life. So somebody would come to Jesus and a leg would pop back on their body. His supernatural energy would flow and cause miracles to happen. The Bible said as he passed through the crowds and the multitudes, the people began to believe on him, and he would just stand there and his glory would go out. And the Bible said, and he healed them all without even having to touch anybody, without even having to be next to anybody, because their faith tuned to the frequency of the power and caused that power to come in their body. Asked a woman with the issue of blood, had been plagued for 12 long years. Her faith said, if I can touch it, I can have it. And Jesus said, if you can touch it, you got it. If you can hear me, you can have me. If you can tune your ears to hear my voice, you can have everything that I say. If you will make your heart the kind of heart that can receive what I have to say. The Bible said immediately, not next week, immediately, the wound dried up immediately. Healing came to her body because there's power in Jesus. Jesus in in his person, not in Buddha, not in Muhammad, not in any other person but Jesus. The only reason, you know why Jesus healed the sick? Because it was in his DNA to heal the sick. He couldn't come across somebody sick and not restore them back to the original intention when God created them. In the Garden of Eden, everything he made, when he was done, he said it was good. When he comes in contact with stuff that's not good, his power makes it good. His glory makes it good. That's why it's important to what in conclusion have you come to about Jesus? What do you believe about Jesus? If you got a Hollywood version, that ain't good enough. If you got a storybook version, that pales in comparison. You need a Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John imagination of Jesus to where you see him speak the word only into your house. That's when you know you really believe what God says. You understand the authority and the power of God.
Jesus. Now I went real fast to say stuff.
That same word that created everything came out of the mouth of Jesus, went back that way, went back to the house, beat the servants home. And when they got there, it jumped on the bed of the afflicted and restored him. The word of God moved faster than the speed of sound. It moved at light speed. It crackled like lightning and went and restored that man because he understood authority. Do you think that you're going to progress into the supernatural without an understanding of authority? Here you are with the Holy Ghost tongue talking, baptized in the blood, washed in the blood, saved, got the word of God. There wasn't no Bible in the centurion's day. He couldn't turn no Bible. It was all in Hebrew or it was in Aramaic. He couldn't read that stuff for us, we know. You got a Bible with all these books in it. You got tons and tons of books by everybody else that's been wrote about the Bible. In your phone is scriptures. If you don't want to read, it will read it for you. You got the Holy Ghost. That's not goosebumps. That's the third person of the Godhead living in your belly. You have a new created spirit that has the DNA of Jesus in it that makes you a son. You've been put in an office that's far above. And you struggle. The struggle. Every time the winds and waves, Jesus, you sleeping, Jesus. You slipping, Jesus. You sleeping. Where you at, Lord? Jesus told him, he said, "O ye of little energy." Jesus is the person of faith. The more you hear about Jesus, faith creates and generates. Faith comes by Jesus. The anointing is Jesus in energy form. The blood of Jesus is Jesus in liquid form. That's Jesus. It ain't a part of him. It ain't a piece. It is him. Because our God is quantum. Every small part of him is equal to the whole. That's what quantum mechanics says. He was beyond Einstein before Einstein got here. His blood is him. His anointing is him. When the anointing come upon you, it ain't a goosebump. It ain't a funny bit. That's energy Jesus. It's intelligent. It ain't just the goosebumps. It's a thinking energy. It goes right to the cancer. Goes right to the tumor. Goes right to the high blood pressure. Goes right to the cells. Go right to where it's supposed to go because it's him. So when you dishonor the anointing, you're dishonoring him. When you breach the blood of Jesus, you're breaching him. He is all. All is him. That man said, "I understand authority. Speak the word." He didn't know if Jesus was going to do it. He said, "But I know how these things work. I know if you say it, it's going to happen. I'm good. Speak the word." Jesus spoke the word. Jesus said, "This is the highest form of faith." He was in a town where they thought they knew who he was. There are people that think they know who you are and they want to hold your past to you. Stuff that you did 5 years ago, 10 years ago. They think you that's the person. They don't know who you are in Christ anymore. Who is this? And talking about prophesying. Girl, he into something new again. He always doing something. Honey, she thinks she this. I know her. Jesus went back to his hometown, and the Bible says he could do no mighty miracle there. Why? Because they were familiar with him. They had came to a conclusion about him, and he couldn't do anything else more for them. Save he touch a few sick folks, minor illness, by the laying up on hands. Laying up on hands works when nothing else will. Because that's the lowest form of faith that I have to touch you for it to happen. See, God has measures for everybody at different levels. Some people need the power of touch and feel a transmission. They need it. Some people say, just call me on the phone and pray over the phone. I believe I get it. What is your revelation of Jesus? What conclusions have you come to about Jesus? Your range of your faith is going to be the deciding factor of the manifestation in your life. According to the measure that you meet, it will be measured back to you. I'm not teaching foreign language. This is what the Bible teaches. Did you enjoy this message? No, did you really get something out of it? That's not bad for 50. No. The conclusions you come to about Jesus will determine what you teach your children about Jesus. Whether your children learn they can depend on Jesus or not. If they see you falling apart and don't know you, they say, well, mama can't trust Jesus. I can't trust him either. I got to get what I got to do, what I got to do. But when they see mom and daddy get on their knees and say, we got a God that's able. We're going to take the word of God, son. Come on now. We're going to pray. Jesus is going to work it. We're going to pray. We're going to believe God. God says, that's my reputation on the line, huh? You didn't put me in this in front of your kids? You didn't put me in front of your kids? You're trying to pull me in front of your kids. You putting all this on me in front of your kids. They watching me. Go on down there and turn it out. When your angels go down there and do it, go down there. Take them that money. Pay that house off. Turn it around because God cares about how children see him. His reputation means everything to him. Do you know what the definition of God's glory is? It's his reputation. God's glory is his reputation. His rep is on the line. See, when you're trying to believe the promises, man, but I just, it's so hard, trouble, pressure's everywhere. Oh, my God, it's so hard to believe. Lord, could you just do it? Lord, help my unbelief. You struggling, having a battle of faith because this thing is big that you're facing or seems big. That stuff comes on you. But see, when you understand the other side of it and stop trying to get God to do stuff and stop trying to help God gonna do stuff, but start knowing that he can't lie. He can't change his mind. If he made a promise, he's got to do it. It ain't even about you. His name is on the line. His rep is on the line. He got to do it. He must. He told Abraham, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to swear to myself that I'm going to bless you. No. Abraham, I want to swear with you. No. No, you can't swear with me. Matter of fact, sleep. Abraham fell out. And God walked down that pathway of blood, and he began to say his own name and swear to himself that I'm going to bless him over there. He said, I'm going to swear to myself I'm going to bless you, because you know what, Abraham? You're going to mess it up. You're going to go in here and make an oath that you can't keep. And as soon as you mess up, the whole thing going to fall apart. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to put you on the outside, let you watch what I do. I'm going to swear an oath to you, to myself. I'm going to swear by myself that in blessing you, I'm going to bless you. In blessing you, I'm going to be your enemy's enemy. I'm going to be your shield and your exceeding great reward. He swore by no greater that he can't lie and can't die and can't change. That's a whole nother message. But the fact of the matter is what it all shakes out to, you got to bless me. You got to heal me. You got to. I swear an oath. You signed in blood an oath that you're going to bless me. You got to do it. I'm going to sleep now because you got to do it. I'm praising and rejoicing because you got to do it. You shouldn't throw your name around and swear to stuff that you ain't going to do. You said, I'm the head and not the tail. I'm blessed going in, blessed coming, blessed in the city, blessed in the field. Bless my enemies are your enemies. They better watch how they handle me and touch. I ain't about to fight back and get into them. No, they touching me, they touching you. Ain't that what you said? If they put their hands on me, they putting their hands on you. Didn't you say that my children are a heritage? You said, I didn't say. You said that by your stripes, I was healed. You didn't say could be. You said I was healed. You said. that you will supply all of my need according to your unlimited resources. You said you shouldn't have said it if you wasn't going to do it. I'm going to go tell everybody you don't keep your promises if you don't do what you said. I'm going to tell everybody you let me hanging by a thread and then you cut the thread and I fell into the ocean and never to be seen again. I'm going to tell everybody you save, but you don't take care of folk. You talk to God like that, I sure do. Especially when I'm fussing and going through stuff and walking the floor and I ask, Lord, you said you got to do it. Sometimes you got to talk to yourself to convince yourself to come to the right conclusion. Does this make sense to anybody? Let's stand up on your feet. Yeah, let's go pray. Hallelujah. He told me, go ahead and pray for me if you want to pray for him. We'll see. We want to be led by the Holy Ghost. Sometimes this message needs to marinate. How many heard something that triggered you? You're like, whoa, that triggered faith in me. How many heard something that hit home? Okay, it's the quickest way to say it. How many of y'all heard something and a light bulb went on? Oh, I see that clearly. See, that's revelation coming to you. When you start having revelation, that means the Holy Ghost is communing to your heart. What that means is he's about to do it. He wouldn't take the trouble of opening your spirit up and not do all the rest. If it's hitting your spirit, that's because God is communing to your heart. The eyes of your understanding are being flooded with light. How many feel like your faith went up a notch after you heard this message? Oh. See, that's how you know that's from the word of the Lord, because faith cometh by hearing. See, if I was preaching self-help and nonsense and foolishness, you'd go away feeling good, but your faith wouldn't be up. The first thing you have to do sometimes is do some repenting. Who do I think I am to doubt him? Who do I think I am? Do you know God takes it a personal offense when you sit around judging that he going to do something he can't do it? He says, like, you know, I'm going to overlook that. I'm going to overlook that foolishness because you don't really know. I'm going to have to overlook this to help you. Who do you think you are to think I can't do something? Who do you think I am to think I don't love like this? I'm lavish. I'm generous. I bless beyond blessing. I bless you so much that it makes you a blessing. Other folks are just blessed to be around you. It's overflowing from you. Are you listening to me? Soften the music up just a little bit. Take it down. Just in the background. There you go. Who are you to doubt him? Who are you to question him? King of kings. Majesty. He is majesty. He ain't trying to be royal. He is royalty. Who are we to keep thinking, I don't know if you'll do it or not? Or you think I won't do it because you done messed up. So you thought I was blessing you because you was good. Gotcha. So you don't know how these things work, do you? Abraham, I'm going to have to show you that I'm going to bless you even when you lying about who your wife is. Even when you being stupid and doubting me, I'm going to be consistent when you are in.